Jamyang Norbu was born in Darjeeling and lived in India for most of his life until he moved to the U.S. Early in his life, he fought with the Tibetan resistance in Mustang in northern Nepal. Later, he worked for the Tibetan government in exile. He was also a founding director of the Tibetan Center for Advanced Studies in Namsal, India. He served as a director of the Tibetan Institute of Performing Arts and also was the manager of the first Tibetan culture troupe to tour internationally. Jamyang Norbu is an author. He has written several books, plays, pamphlets, and traditional Tibetan opera, Liberato. He is also the winner of Crossword Award, India's equivalent of the Booker Prize for his book, The Mandala of Sherlock Holmes. Jamyang Norbu has lectured on Tibetan culture and the freedom struggle at more than 100 universities and institutions in the US, Canada, Australia, France, and India, Japan, and the UK. He has also appeared on a number of television and radio shows and interviews all over the world to argue the cause of Tibet. He has a well-known blog called Shadow Tibet, where he comments on current social and political events inside and outside of Tibet. The International Herald Tribune has described Jamyang Norbu as one of the most incisive and prolific commentators on the political scene, as a writer with strong opinions about, but also the wide reading and intellectual depth to back them up, sometimes fiercely. Ladies and gentlemen, Jamyang Norbu.
I'd like to thank the Tibetan Youth Congress and the Tibetan Youth Group here in Utah for inviting me. I was first here in 1974 when I bought the Tibetan Institute of Performing Arts on their tour, and I've always enjoyed coming back here. Coming down, flying down into the valley, it's like being back in Lhasa again. Although I was born in Darjeeling, I lived in Lhasa for 2 years when I was a kid. And this is one place that still reminding me of the city of my childhood. So thank you very much for inviting me. It's always been my pleasure. And I would have loved to talk about something, you know, much more pleasant. But there's a reality that we have to all face, especially when we are Tibetans or supporters of Tibet. And that is what is going on in Tibet right now. We all know, I think some of you, even if you're not Tibetans, you may have heard or, you know, read reports of at least 107 people who've burnt themselves to death. Most of them very young people, teenagers, some of them, monks and nuns, which has shocked the Tibetan world. So I've tried to put some of my thoughts down on paper to discuss this with you. I'll try not to. How much time do I have, by the way, if I may ask? Is this your turn? Okay, all right. So, and then I'll try to discuss this and why it's happening in Tibet, and then maybe after that, any questions you have, not necessarily on this subject or on politics, you know, on Tibetan culture or whatever questions you have, I'll try to field them for you, okay? There has been little reporting of this phenomenon in the international media, and far less discussion. There's been practically no discussion. No late night pundits have been holding forth on this at all. Although you must, and we Tibetans in some ways are a very kind of humble sort of people, and we say, oh, well, you know, we're a small community. But what's happening in Tibet is not small. When you have, in the space of 2 years, kids burning themselves, 107 of them, it's a big, big, big deal. You had the Arab Spring, which was precipitated by the self-immolation of one Tunisian street vendor, Mohammed Bouazizi. And he caused that. He caused the whole Middle East, you know, were practically now, you know, in chaos, which we, you know, we are still seeing the consequences of it in Syria, in Egypt, in a lot of other places, and Libya even. So this is big. The only reason why people don't pay attention to it is frankly because the bad guy in this scenario is not some Middle Eastern kind of autocrat, but it's China. And everyone in the world owes money to China, especially the United States. So it changes the discussion right there. That's why Tibetans must be aware of that reality and not feel in any way that our cause is any less or the heroism of our people is any less. What's going on is something that must be discussed. And I'm glad to discuss it with anyone, anytime, And it's really important that we not only discuss this, but we be able to publicize it in the world, because it's not just a question of young people burning themselves in despair. There's much more underlying it. For instance, I think, the influence that China has, not only on governments and economy, it's there's on the media also. The New York Times has a reputation of being the newspaper of record for the United States, the most important newspaper. Washington Post comes a close second. But these days, in their centerfold, they publish a copy of the China Daily once a month. And China Daily is the propaganda organ of the Communist Party of China. And it comes in between. It's paid. It's actually a kind of a paid advertisement. But normally when other countries pay for advertisement, it's to advertise, tourist spots or, their industries or for business. But no, the China Daily comes out of politics. It's trying to influence the American people's way of thinking. And this is happening in the New York Times. They come out with it once a month. It's happening in the Washington Post. Even in Hollywood. All the Hollywood movies that we see are pre-censored. There are Chinese censors, representatives in Los Angeles. Movies like, you might have seen this called Red Dawn. It's about the, it's a new version of an old 70s film about the Russians invading the United States. But in the new version, they had China invading the United States, and the Chinese censor said, no, no, no. So they changed it to North Koreans. They digitally altered the badges of the soldiers there. But this is just one instance. Dozens of movies. Some movies, right? China doesn't, it's not even, the main, there's a movie called Salmon Fishing in the Yemen or something. Some of you may have seen it. It really has nothing to do with China. It's about Yemen and Scotland. But China's mentioned incidentally, so the censors wanted that to be changed so that reference is favorable to China. So it swings a lot of weight these days. And that is one reason why what's happening in Tibet to a great degree is ignored in the world. And even in our own community, in the Tibetan world, there's been a lot of confusion on what's happening in Tibet. When these young people started committing self-immolation, there was a lot of talk about the reasons why they were doing so. And even Tibet support groups were saying they're doing it for human rights, or some of them said they're doing it for religious freedom. And that was picked up in a number of Western papers. Religious freedom. Yes, because there's a stereotype. Tibetans are religious people. So if they kill themselves, they must be doing it for religion. Which is a stereotype. It's like saying black people are very good at basketball, So there's the whole idea, Tibetans, religion, yes, of course. The connection is made. But it's not that simple. The slogan that a lot of these people, before they died, before they burnt themselves, they came out shouting, a couple, in some cases, a few slogans. One was freedom for Tibet. Rangwang, they used the term. And also some of them used the term Rangzen, which means independence. And the third slogan that everyone had was that the Dalai Lama must return. So was this just an expression of loyalty to the Dalai Lama? I don't think it was. It's in a way a slogan, it's a symbol. The Dalai Lama is a symbol. He is not the symbol of a religious leader for Tibetans. You must realize that. Because the Dalai Lama, you know, there are a lot of religious leaders in Tibet. If you ask Tibetans, who is your Tsawai Lama, your root guru, there are a number of different root gurus, you know. People take their chair from different lamas. The Dalai Lama essentially is the sovereign ruler of Tibet. And this is traditionally his role. So when we talk of the Dalai Lama, when you talk, say that the Dalai Lama must return, we are saying that he must return to a free Tibet, to his independent Tibet. And recently this has become even more pronounced, some of the last few immolations. There was one nun called Sangye Roma, a very young nun, and she took a picture of herself, and that I think she sent out through her, you know, that some of her friends had sent out. She had written a very lovely poem, a very patriotic poem, but you know, she had tattooed or maybe just written with a marker on her hands, and you could see in the photograph it says "Her Rangzang Gegap, Tibet, an independent nation." Then recently in Tao, there was this another nun, Panden Chöso, and she had left, before she died, in the last will and testament, she had said she's doing this for Tibetan independence. And when she burnt herself on the main square of Tao, she, you know, some people had, you know, burnt themselves and gone running, but she just stood still. Very impressive, just going up in flames. And then another lady, a very young lady, there's even a video that's come out, going up to her, quite close to the flames, with these Tibet, you know, the white kind of scarves that we have called kathaks, which is, in some ways, we offer to Tibet, to our friends, or you know, which we use in weddings. It's a kind of symbol of good luck, a symbol of purity, and it's offered to her. People have also been prostrating. So there's a recognition on the part of the Tibetan public that these people are giving up their lives, not in despair, not because they feel hopeless, but they're doing it for us, for our cause. So, one of the arguments that we had also was from some people, you know, people who felt that the slogans that the Tibetans were shouting at that time during these immolations, that the Dalai Lama must return, is purely concerned with His Holiness as a religious leader. And so we've had some arguments back and forth on this. But one of my feelings on this is that when their slogan that the Dalai Lama must return is reflected in previous freedom struggles in South Africa, when Nelson Mandela was in jail and the white supremacist regime was imposing its will on the black population, when they had apartheid. What was the slogan at that time? Was it freedom for black people, freedom for South Africans? No. They had a very simple slogan. It says, "Free Nelson Mandela." And that was repeated all over the world. They just used that slogan. That didn't mean that if just Nelson Mandela was freed, then the problem is solved. No, of course not. But he was a symbol. So it said, "Free Nelson Mandela." So if Nelson Mandela is free, then that's one step for African freedom. So when Tibetans say the Dalai Lama must return to Tibet, doesn't mean that if he just returns to Tibet like a tourist and the Chinese allow him, then our problems are solved. Of course not. They're talking in symbolic terms, that he must return there as the leader of a free and independent Tibet and return to the Pongala Palace. And that's how I interpret it. Because I have been studying other freedom movements in the world, and people do use these symbols. It's, you know, you just can't use a normal slogan because it doesn't have poetry. But, and when you're going to use something like in Poland, you know, when the communist regime, Jaruzelski, was suppressing the Polish people, especially the Polish shipyard workers, their symbol, their slogan was solidarity. In Polish, solidarność.